time. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He. Lift up your banner, let the anthems ring. Praises to our King. Great and mighty is the Lord our God. Great and mighty is He.
Amen, amen. All right. Wonderful, wonderful. Good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Good to see all of you. I'm thankful for His blessings and thankful for Him watching over us, taking care of us today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Ask Him to be with us tonight. Good to see Brother Barry here tonight. Pray for us, Brother Barry. Amen.
Dear Father, Lord, we just thank you, God, for all the many blessings of life. Father, I just thank you, Father, for touching us during this storm. Father, we just close us without water. Father, I heard that it came back on today. We praise you for that. Lord, we just thank you for being here this evening. And Father, we just ask that you bless every man with our prayer list that we're going to talk about after a while. And Lord, we just love you and praise you in Christ's name.
Amen. Amen. I want to remind you, of course, Sunday is homecoming. Homecoming Sunday here at 4 Mile Baptist Church. We'll start at 10:30. Living Faith will be here to sing for us. We're in for a jam-up service. I hope you're planning to be here, and I hope you're inviting others to come and be a part of our service here at 4 Mile, 10:30 this coming Sunday. And then Monday through Wednesday, we'll start our revival at 7 o'clock each night, Monday through Wednesday. Brother Larry Weaver will be here to preach for us from Paulding County, pastors the Victory Baptist Church. And, of course, they have the Victory Christian Academy there. And I'm excited that he could be with us next week. And I'm excited about that. I hope you're inviting folks to come and be a part of that service. Those services, amen. I've been praying hard and inviting folks. And I've got many promises. And I'm looking for those promises and reminding folks to come. Amen. I hope you are too. Well, if you have your Bibles with you, open them tonight with us to the book of Luke. Luke's Gospel chapter number 11. Luke's Gospel chapter number 11. We've been looking, of course, over the last several weeks, just practical things from the Word of God. So we've been praying about what He'd have us to look at in these weeks. And, of course, as we've been anticipating revival coming next week and different things, just been praying about different things and asking God to help us over these last few weeks. And I'm thankful for Brother Ricky Biddle being here last week. And, that was an awesome message, right on time. I'm telling you, God makes no mistakes, and I'm glad He doesn't. Amen. Luke's Gospel, chapter number 11. If you're able and can stand with me, I want to read these verses and ask the Lord to help us tonight as we look at a very familiar thought or a very familiar passage of Scripture. Maybe look at it a little different tonight than maybe you have looked at it, and look at it from a practical standpoint of view, and talk about it for a few moments right from the Word of God. We get many answers from the Word of God when we look at them and ask God to help us. The Holy Spirit teaches us. We looked at the Holy Spirit a few weeks ago. Very practical look at the Holy Spirit, how He helps us with the Word of God. Luke chapter number 11, Jesus hears, the Bible gives us the scene, and then Jesus talks to His disciples. The Bible says here, "And it came to pass that as He was praying in a certain place, when He ceased, one of His disciples said unto Him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And He said unto them, When ye pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so in earth. Give us day by day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Here you have Luke's account of the model, what we call the model prayer. It's God, the Lord Jesus, teaching His disciples how to pray. Look at verse number 5 with me. "And He said unto them, Which of you shall have a friend, and shall go unto him at midnight, and say unto him, Friend, Lend me three loaves, for a friend of mine in his journey is come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. I say unto you, though he will not rise and give him, because he is his friend, yet because of his importunity, he will rise and give him as many as he needeth. Now look at this verse. And I say unto you, ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be open. Now notice these verses. Verse number 11. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he shall ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? You can be seated. I want to look at these verses tonight, and I want to talk to you about a very familiar topic in the Word of God, but I want to talk to you about it in a different manner, I guess in a practical manner tonight, a very simple thought, but a very practical one. I find more and more in the Word of God and in our society today, many people that are still learning how to understand the Word of God and apply it to our lives. I want to talk to you tonight about getting our prayers answered. How do you get prayers answered? How do you pray with the intention of hearing from God to where God will hear and answer our prayers? Principles to powerful praying. How do you pray and know that God does hear your prayers and answer your prayers? Now, many times we pray. I'm not going to say thousands, but over my lifetime, I've met thousands of people that claim to pray. But I often want to say, and I'll ask you tonight, not looking for your answer out loud, how do you know God answers your prayer? If I were to put you on the spot and ask you that tonight, how would you answer it? What would be your answer? How do you know God answers your prayer? What would be your response to that question? How to use the powerful weapon of prayer. I believe the Word of God shows us and teaches us, just like Jesus said earlier in this chapter, when his disciple come to him after he was witnessed by them watching him pray, as they come to him and said, now I find in the scripture, of course, they didn't ask him, Lord, show us how to do miracles. They didn't say, Lord, show us how to do this and show us how. They said, Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. They saw, of course, something in his prayer life that they saw that was powerful. That they saw that was powerful. And they said, Lord, teach us to pray. As John also taught his disciples, teach us, show us, help us with this prayer. They saw the intent and the mighty powerful weapon of prayer. And I believe God reveals to us some things in his word that will help us in our practical study, our practical thought of prayer. I believe there's seven simple questions you could ask concerning your own prayer life right now, your own simple prayers, how you pray now, as to whether or not you have a powerful prayer life and whether or not God answers prayer. That I believe it, the Bible teaches us on getting your prayers answered, whether or not they line up with what God's word says. So let's hasten to them tonight. Now, let me give them to you right quick. First of all, I want you to see, do you realize who you're praying to? Now, I had the wonderful privilege yesterday of standing right there between the governor and his wife and having my picture made. It ain't a happen every day. That's something that just don't happen every day. Something you don't get the opportunity to do every day. Got a chance to shake hands with both of them, talk to both of them, tell both of them that I pray for them, and talk to them a few minutes. Can I just go ahead and say, he didn't ask me who I was. I was disappointed. He didn't ask me, watch this, he didn't ask me what I needed. He didn't ask me how he could help me. He didn't ask me, the governor did not ask me, hey, what do you need? What can I do for you? Here's my personal telephone number. If you have a problem, night or day, call me and I'll help you. He's a prominent man in our state, and I thank God for him. I really do. I thank God for him. I thank God for the stands he's took, and I thank God for how he helped us through COVID. And I told him some of that yesterday when I had the privilege of talking to him and standing and had a few minutes with him, actually. But he didn't ask me none of that. But can I tell you, I serve a God in heaven that says that. Look at this verse, Hebrews chapter number 4. The Bible says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was at all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore, or because of all that, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy, watch this, and find grace to help in time of need. Somebody far more important than the governor of this state, someone far more important that has far more resources than any governor, president, or ruler of this world, says we can come boldly to his throne anytime, day or night, and find help in time of need. Do you realize when you pray who you're talking to? Do you? Hello? Well, Lord, I just want to come for you in a hurry. I'm on the way to work, but Lord, I just need to talk to you for just a minute. Is that the way you talk to him? We don't rush into his presence some kind of now. I have had to talk that fast in praying before, but I'm talking about on a regular basis. Do you have a regular time of communion with God to where you're on a regular communication with God to where you're not rushing in like an errand boy and saying, Lord, I got a situation here I need to talk to you about? That's not how you would rush into some dignitary's throne room. And you sure wouldn't rush in like a divine vending machine to put in your prayer and pull a lever saying, Lord, this is what I need today. No, God wants a relationship. He wants to hear about your situation. He wants to hear how you're seeing your situation so he can help you see what's really going on in your situation. Did you get that? Do you realize who to whom you're praying? You see, this means God wants to talk to us. God wants us to understand who we're talking to. You remember what God told Moses when he revealed himself to Moses? He's on the backside of that desert. He's been watching sheep, and he notices the burning bush. Now, he's seen burning bushes before, but there's something different about this one. You go back and read it. There's something different about this one that caught his attention. And God didn't reveal himself to him until he walked over to the bush. Watch this. And the Bible says God then spoke to him out of that bush. Exodus chapter number 3 and verse number 5. And the Bible says, and he said, draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. You realize when we come into the presence of God, it's holy ground. You're not just haphazardly walking in and say, hey, God, I just want to talk to you. We want to jive a little bit. I was watching some show last night and said, we've had a little do-si-dos. Me and God, we've had our little, no. He's not no do-si-do God. I'm not trying to belittle whoever, whatever kind of relationship this person has with God. I don't know. I'm not judging him. I'm just saying, God is a holy God. And if you don't see him that way, one day you'll stand before him. You'll realize he is holy. Now, I'm glad I got a good relationship with God. I'm glad, but it's through the Lord Jesus Christ that I enter the throne room. It means he wants us to come. We can come. Now, don't get it wrong. Don't take it to the far extreme and say, I'm not sure if I can go in and talk. No. We can come boldly to the throne of grace. We can come and talk to him. But it's with reverence because of who he is, realizing who he is, realizing what he can do, realizing those things. You see, Jesus is teaching them the model prayer, the Lord's Prayer, what we call, I was taught the Lord's Prayer. Matthew chapter 6, verse number 9, after this manner, therefore pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now he uses those phrases, in heaven. He's reminding us that God the Father is in heaven. That's who we're praying to through him. And of course, he sets us apart. He's setting us apart from sin. You can't come into God's presence with sin in your heart. See some more about that in a little bit. But and of course, he is to be hallowed. His name is to be hallowed. Means that God's name is holy. We should never misuse his name or use it carelessly. But realize who he is. Realize the power of his name. Here's the second thing. I'm rushing. Have I confessed all my sin? You see, you can't just casually walk into the presence of God unclean. If I regard iniquity in my heart. Too many times we rush into God's presence asking when we should be confessing. See, sometimes we misunderstand that very fact, that we're just going to use God as a spare tire and not keep our relationship clean with him. That doesn't mean that, you know, we can have a slip of the tongue and break our relationship where we can't talk to him. No, God is a forgiving God, and God will forgive us, and he does understand those things. He remembers that we're dust. He knows those things. But when he brings to our attention, when we understand the reverence of who we're talking to, and we understand the setting of where we're going into, it should bring a conviction to our heart. Am I right with you, Lord? Is our relationship right? Search our soul kind of thing. The psalmist said, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. And as we confess our sin, we need to realize that most of us are not guilty of murder or adultery or drunkenness or bank robbery or those kind of things. But we do have sin. Yeah, there's none of us perfect. Hello? The Bible says, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 31, it says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Now, you notice the sins he's talking about? Specifically and completely confess all bitterness. You got bitterness in your heart? Sometimes it'll take root if you don't confess it, if you don't get it out. And he talks about, that's, of course, refusing to forgive those who hurt us. People do hurt us, by the way. If you hadn't been hurt lately, you need to check your heart. It may be getting hard. Huh? But you got to let it go when it happens. And pray and ask God to help you let it go quick. Amen. Huh? Those people may not even realize it. Quote that verse often. Father, forgive them what? For they know not what they do. A lot of people hurt us and don't even realize it. It's okay. God, they don't even know it. And then he says we must do what? With all wrath. Outbursts of tempers and anger. Oh boy, if you drive on the road much, you see some of that. We still have those problems, don't we? People still have those problems. They're late. And they're trying to get where they're going, and man, you're just trying to obey the law, trying to stay out of their way, and it still don't seem like enough, huh? Confess all anger. Emotions that often reveal itself in wrath, clamor, basically those loud assertions of yelling with anger. And get rid of all evil speaking. Oh, God help it. Help me. Oh, my. Evil speaking, preacher? We get around that conversation, next thing we're in it. We're talking bad about what? Anything, everything. Okay. There's plenty to talk bad about, ain't there? Huh? Hello. And what does it do? It drags us down. Sure it does. Evil speaking. And we're tempted to put others down by gossip and rumors. And sometimes, you know, I've had to back up and say, wait a minute. I don't even know if that's true. We tend to think because of this, because of that, and I don't know if any of that's true. Let's just stop right there. Let's just stop that. We don't know if that's true or not. Amen? God help me. Malice. Malice is deliberately running or attempting to hurt another person with words and actions. Remembering, how do we deal with this? Remembering that what? Heart is deceitful. Whose heart? Our hearts. Jeremiah said it this way, Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? They can't but one know it, God. How do you know that, preacher? Because we're often can't even see our own sin. I raise both hands on that because I pray often, Lord, show me myself. It's not a pretty picture. You say, and you're talking about when you get up first thing in the morning? No, I'm talking about when I see some of the things I've done. Christ-like is who we ought to be. I'm preaching to myself more than anybody here, I guess. But when we pray, what are you saying, preacher? When we pray, confessing our sins, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. So do I realize to whom I'm praying, and have I confessed my sins? Here's the third thing, we're moving on. Is my prayer specific? Now, why do you say that, preacher? God bless the world. God bless all the people in the world. God bless the sick. God help all the people that are sick get better. Now, those are good prayers. That's the kind of prayers my little grandchildren pray. Is that the kind of prayers you pray as an adult? Maybe if you're still young in the faith. Lord, remember the sick. What does that mean? Has he forgotten them? Lord, fish your will, save people. You're just showing your ignorance. Read your Bible. It's not God's will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. I'm not picking on anybody's prayers. I'm just saying, do you pray specifically? Now, why would you say that? Sometimes we pray, Lord, please bless so-and-so. I prayed that. I often pray that. I still pray that sometimes. The word bless, eulogio, eulogio, what does it sound like? Yeah, eulogy. That's where we get our word eulogy. So when we ask God to bless somebody, what does it mean? We want to go to their funeral soon? No, I'm being facetious because the word bless, it means to speak well or to make someone prosper. That's what bless means, to speak well of or to make someone prosper, Lord. Help them, Lord. It's often a catch-all word, though. You know what? We often use it as a catch-all. Lord, bless them. And we use it. It's okay. But the Bible says in James chapter 4, you lust and have not, you kill and desire to have, and cannot obtain, you fight and war, yet ye have not because ye ask not. Think about that for a second. That means we don't ask specifically. You don't go into a fine restaurant and say, they bring you a menu and you just look it over and you say, bring me some food and something to drink. Is that what you do? Well, no, you wouldn't do that. Yet that's what we do with God, ain't it? Let me just go ahead and hit you with a question because God did me. If you do not specifically ask when you pray, how do you know God answers. Answer that question. How do you know God answers? But how do you know? If you're not being specific with God in your prayers, how do you know God answers? How close are you to God? What's your communication with God? What's your personal relationship with God? I've got specific with God with things. I've watched Him do it time after time. Now, there's some criteria when you get specific with God. Say some more about that in a few moments. Be sure when we pray specific, as we pray about the when and the how in our specific, we need to remember the why we're asking specifically. Did you hear that? Why are we asking God to do this? Why do we want God to answer this prayer? You see, the next verse after verse number 2 there says, you ask and receive not because you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your own lust. That's the reason God don't answer. But yet He says you have not because you ask not. But there's a right reason. I'll say some more about that in just a moment. Here's number 4. Do I believe God will answer? Do you believe God will answer when you pray? Do you really believe God is going to answer that prayer you just prayed? Oh my. Conviction, boy, I'm telling you, God convicted me as I was working on this study. How many times have I prayed? Did I really believe God would answer that prayer? Oh, I wanted Him to, but did I really believe He would? Do I realize to whom I'm praying and when we pray? When we're speaking to God who spoke the world, the universe into existence. Matthew chapter 19, verse 26. Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Wow. More than 330 times in the Bible, God is called Almighty. There's a reason why He's called Almighty. You know why? He is Almighty. There's no one, nothing like Him. Almighty. There's no doubt in our minds of His ability to answer our prayers. There's no doubt in our minds as to what He can do. Is that the way it is when we pray? God only answers prayers in faith. James chapter 1. Verse 5, the Bible says, if you any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like the wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. Jesus told the blind men, Matthew chapter 9, verse 29, according to your faith be it unto you. Now, if that's the way it is, no wonder sometimes my prayers weren't answered. Hello, I'm just confessing. No wonder God didn't answer that prayer. I wasn't believing that He would. You have that problem? You don't have to answer. See, they're not limited by God's power. They're limited by our faith sometimes. Whether or not we believe. I'm not talking about a false belief. I'm talking about believing in God. Matthew chapter 21, verse 22. And all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believe, and you shall receive. Now, that's not a vending machine prayer, God. Oh, there's conditions there. But as we grow in our worship and grow in our faith and we grow in the knowledge of God's will, we can ask. Knowing it's in the will of God, knowing it's in accordance with His word and His teaching, and we can see God do, believing He will. Here's number 5. Am I doing my part? My part? My part. There's a part we play in prayer. Here it is, Ephesians chapter 3 and verse number 20. Oh my, God help me, boy. I'm telling you, I told you it was convicting. Man's been beating me up all week, huh? We must be willing to put feet on our prayers. have no business asking God to comfort and encourage someone unless we're doing our part. I've been trying to do better in this realm. Pray for somebody and say, Lord, help them. You know what they're going through. And God will say, well, have you done your part to encourage them? Oh, me. Have you told them you're praying for them? Have you told them that I know where they're at? Have you told them that I prompted your heart to remind them that I know where they're at? Oh, Lord. Have you told them? Have you reached out to them? You know they're in need. Have you reached out to them to just say, hey, I know their need too? I'm not beating on, I know I'm preaching to the choir tonight. These are the folks that really love God. They say if you come on Sunday morning, you know, you love your church. If you come on Sunday night, you love your pastor. If you come on Wednesday night, you love God. That's what somebody said. I didn't invent that. I didn't originate that. But I'm just saying, I'm not picking on anybody tonight. I'm picking on me more than anybody because, man, I'm telling you, it's been really, really convicting for me. We ask God to help our church. We ask God to help whatever. And God says, are we willing to do our part? And I know many of you have been doing your part. And I thank God for you. And it's been convicting me to watch you do your part. And it's been inspiring me to help me to do more of my part. Get more involved. It really has. Now unto him, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to what? The power that worketh in us. Who are the hands and feet of God in this world? It's us, his church. That's the reason he left us here. And we've watched that work so tremendously this past week as people needed water and supplies and food and all kinds of things. You wouldn't believe the stories I've heard and the stories I've experienced this week. People trying to meet needs and me trying to meet needs as well. But you know what? You know what? You watched our county or the heart of our county suffer with this water situation. But watch this. I thought about it as I've been preaching on this end time series. What happens when the church is gone? Oh, wow. Oh, yeah, I'm sure there'll be people that will, whatever, help, you know, when tragedy strikes. But the compassion of God's people, as Jesus had compassion upon people, there's nothing like it. Nothing like it. God help us to have his compassion. For our prayers to be answered, the Bible teaches us we must be actively doing our part to bring them to pass, because God wants us to be a part of that, to see him answer the prayers. You see? Be a part to see him do the work. It's amazing. Oh my. He does it. Through powerful stuff on earth, his children of faith, not through angels, not all the time, but through his children. Here's six, number six. Is it God's will? That's a big one. Is it God's will? Always must pray in accordance with God's will. The purpose of prayer is not to get our will in heaven, but to get God's will done on earth. You get that? That's why Jesus showed us in the model prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. He not only taught us to pray in accordance with God's will, but he also set the example. How did he do that? Well, when he's facing the cross, he himself facing an obstacle, man, that was so big and so mighty. Him in the human body and the human flesh was up against a mighty, up against death itself. He knew it was coming. Luke chapter 22, verse 42. He's saying, Father, if it be thy will, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. Knowing what was coming, knowing what he was facing. He's praying, not my will, but thine be done. When we pray, we don't demand, oh no. Name it, claim it. Oh, I'm claiming it in Jesus' name. Watch it. You better claim God's will in Jesus' name if you want to claim something. You see, praying in line with God's will is essential to answered prayer. God's not going to do anything against his own word and against his will. 1 John chapter 5, verse 14 and 15 reminds us, and this is the confidence that we have, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desire of him. I thought about Jesus standing there at Lazarus' tomb. You remember what he said? When he started to pray. He could have just walked up to the tomb and said, Lazarus, come forth. But he didn't. He's got everybody's attention there. And he prays. And he says, Father, I thank thee that thou hearest me. Isn't that amazing? Go back and look at it. John chapter 11. It's amazing what he says there. I'm gonna go back over there and read it to you. Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I say that they may believe that thou hast sent me. Wow. You go home and look at that. Study that out. That'll change you. Unbelievable. It's amazing, ain't it? It really is. Praying in Jesus, praying that God's will be done. Here's the last thing I'm done. Will I pray in Jesus' name? Why do we end our prayers with the phrase, in Jesus' name? We ask this. Amen. Pray in Jesus' name. Some think to pray in Jesus' name is like using a magic wand. No, you got the wrong idea. Jesus' name is our bridge to God. It's like putting a stamp on a letter, what E.B. Hill said. He was going to pray at one of the president's inauguration. He'd been invited to come up and pray at the inauguration. And they sent him a request, called his office, said, we want a copy of your prayer for the inauguration. He said, I hadn't prayed it yet. They said, well, we need a copy of it to approve it before the inauguration. He said, I hadn't prayed it yet. Thought it was so unique, so good. It's true. Hadn't prayed it yet. And later, I don't know if it was that same address, but they said, we don't want you to pray in Jesus' name. He said, that's like trying to mail a letter without a stamp. Oh, no. You pray in Jesus' name. You see, it's the bridge. We don't have a right to be heard by God except through Jesus. Jesus said it this way, John chapter 14, verse number 6. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me, through the Lord Jesus. That's how we're saved, through the Lord Jesus. Suppose I had several thousand dollars in my checking account. And you take one of my personal checks to the bank to get $1,000, and you make the check out to yourself and you sign your name. Then you give it to the teller and you wait to receive the money. Would the teller give you the money? If she did, I would change banks the next day. Sure would. But if I go along and sign the check, would you get the money? Well, of course. Why? Because the authorization. The signature. That's what we're looking for when we pray in Jesus' name. The authorization. Jesus signs the check. John chapter 14, verse 14. If you ask anything in my name, I'll do it. Of course, it's in accordance with his word. It's in accordance with his will. It's It's walking in his steps, praying in Jesus' name. We won't ask for anything which Jesus would not ask or approve. He's authorizing it. You're not going to ask for what he wouldn't ask. You're not going to ask for something he wouldn't approve. For that to be true, you're abiding in his presence. You're attached to him as the vine. John chapter 15, verse number 7. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done. Praying in Jesus' name. We pray in union with Jesus, the person and the purpose, what that name symbolizes, what that name means. To have our prayers answered. What? We realize whom we're praying to. We confess our sins, all of our sins. We pray specifically, and we believe God will answer. And we do our part. When God speaks to us, we do our part. And we pray in accordance with God's will. And we pray in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. God answers prayer. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for what you're showing us from your word. Powerful praying. You want us to do it. You want us to have this weapon of prayer that we can stand forth. You gave us the example in your only begotten Son to help us to be lights in this world, to be the people in these last days. Help us now in Jesus' name. Amen.